Blessed are you, God of glory, through your Son, the Christ. His name is Jesus because he saves his people from their sin. He will be called Emmanuel, God with us. Let us praise the Lord. Let us praise the God of Israel. He has come to his people and set them free. He gave up the glory of heaven and took the form of a servant. The Word was made flesh, and we beheld his glory. In humility, he walked the path of obedience to die on the cross. God raised him to the highest place above and gave him the name above every name, Jesus Christ is Lord. So all beings in heaven and earth will fall at his feet and proclaim the glory of God, Jesus Christ is Lord. This night Christ is born, hallelujah. This night the Savior comes, hallelujah. This night the angels sing on earth, hallelujah. Glory to God in the highest, born to save, you are the light of the world. Glory to God in the highest. Good evening and welcome to Christmas Eve. For the next three quarters of an hour, we will be celebrating with you the Nativity of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We will celebrate this through scripture, through music, and through the proclamation of the word. Our prayers continue to be lifted up so that soon we may again meet together as we worship and praise our God as the body of Jesus Christ. Let us pray. O God, who has caused this holy night to shine with the illumination of the true light, grant us, we beseech thee, that as we have known the mystery of the light upon the earth, so we may also perfectly enjoy him in heaven, where with thee and the Holy Spirit he liveth and reigneth, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen. And now Beth Lang will offer a prayer and light the Christ candle.
Greg and I would like to wish you a very Merry Christmas today. We think of you every day. Please join me in our prayer today. God our Father, today the Savior is born, and those who live in darkness are seeing a great light. Help us who greet the birth of Christ with joy to live in the light of your Son and to share the good news of your love. We ask through Jesus Christ, the light who has come into the world. People of God, shout and sing. Tell the good news of peace on earth. Lord, bring us today into Christ's peace. Amen.
Christmas night, what peace you sing to hear the news the angels bring. News of rich joy, news of rich love, news of a merciful King's child. A very, very happy Christmas to all of you. Let's see what St. Luke has to say about it. Then, after the purification had been completed, in accordance with the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as prescribed in the law of the Lord. Every firstborn male shall be deemed to belong to the Lord. And also to make the offering, as stated in the law, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. There was at that time in Jerusalem a man called Simeon. This man was upright and devout, one who watched and waited for the restoration of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death until he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, he came into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the law required, Simeon took him in his arms, praised God, and said, "Now, Lord, you are releasing your servant in peace according to your promise. For I have seen with mine own eyes the deliverance you have made, ready in full view of all nations, a light that will bring revelation to the Gentiles and glory to your people Israel." The child's father and mother were full of wonder at what was being said about Jesus. There was also a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was a very old woman who had lived 7 years with her husband after she was first married, and then alone as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshiped night and day with fasting and prayer. Coming up at that very moment, she gave thanks to God, and she talked about the child to all who were looking for the liberation of Jerusalem. The Word of God and the Son of God for the people of God.
Why should man on earth be so
Earlier this year, as we were all experiencing coronavirus lockdown, I was researching some technology stocks when I kept on coming across this word FOMO. FOMO, apparently it's an acronym, capitals F-O-M-O. And of course, I ignored it, but it came up too many times, so I had to look into it. And FOMO stands for fear of missing out. In the world of stocks and bonds, FOMO is the sort of panic one feels when a company's valuation price keeps on climbing and climbing, but you're not too sure if or when you should get into the action. Say, for example, you had in 1997 $2,500 to invest, but you thought that $18 per share was way too much for the online bookseller Amazon. Well, today you'd have a serious case of FOMO. That initial 140 shares after several splits would net you an eye-watering $3 million plus. But fear of missing out also applies to other parts of our lives. You may receive a book for Christmas, as I did a few years ago, a book called 100 Places to See Before You Die. Or for the more industrious among us, there's a book, 1,000 Things to See Before You Die. And when you leaf through a book like that, you suddenly realize that there's not many places that you did see. You turn to your husband or your wife and you say, come on now, we got to get a move on. We got to visit at least 50 of these places before we head to the grave. But that's life, isn't it? We want to make the most of what we have so that at life's end, we could look back and say that we've done our best. Of course, the second we realize that we've never been to the Great Wall of China, we contract an instant case of FOMO. Now, there's something I think a little bit strange about this sort of attitude. We spend our whole lives trying to pack in as much pleasure and fun as we could afford, but when the thought of death occurs, we do our level best to ignore or put away any such ideas. In fact, it's the one part of life that we definitely don't want to experience. As Woody Allen famously said, I'm not afraid to die, I just don't want to be there when it happens. And I think if we were to take an informal survey and ask the question, how do you want to die? My guess is that the overwhelming majority of us would only require two things, make it fast and make it a surprise. We all want to fall asleep some night when we're a very old age and poof, just never wake up. It's a surprise and it's fast. Well, the person we're meeting this Christmas Eve is a man who has both a fear of missing out and an anxious attitude towards death. Here in the second chapter of Luke's gospel, this man makes a sort of cameo appearance in the unfolding drama of God's salvation. Luke chapter 2 and verse 25. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. We are given his name and address. His name is Simeon, his address is Jerusalem. He is righteous and devout, righteous meaning that he loves God above all things, and devout meaning that he loves his fellow man. Simeon is waiting for the promised Messiah, the consolation of Israel, another name for the Messiah. He has received the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit has revealed that this elderly gentleman would not die until he sees the Christ, until he sees the Messiah, the Savior. Well, at this point in history, God had been quiet for almost half a millennia. That blank page between the Old and the New Testaments, between the prophet Malachi and Matthew's gospel, that blank page represents about 400 years of God not talking, 400 years of hearing nothing from God. Well, it's safe to say that after four centuries, there's not a huge amount of FOMO going on in Israel in regards to the Messiah. God hadn't spoken for this long, so why should we think that now's the time? The whole idea of Messiah, of a Savior, had been around for so long by this point that most Jews weren't even interested in the whole notion. Here they were, God's chosen people in God's promised land, a land now occupied by the Roman Empire. Elite Jewish families were sending their sons and daughters to Greek-speaking academies. They were learning Hellenistic or Greek philosophy that became infused with Jewish learning. Judaism was becoming secularized. It's pro forma, something that you did even if you didn't believe everything contained in Hebrew scriptures. It was jingoistic, a part of national identity. You see, life was just marked by birth, adolescence, school, work, marriage, work, children, work, old age, and death. Not too much to get worked up about. But Simeon, he had a restless soul. He was on the lookout for this Savior. I imagine Simeon followed the goings-on at the temple. Were there any underground militias that were planning to fight these Roman occupiers? If so, the Messiah could be one of these brave soldiers. Was there any talk about overthrowing Herod, Herod who was complicit in Roman rule? Perhaps the Messiah would challenge his throne and become a new political leader. We're not told how long Simeon has been waiting for Israel's consolation. Maybe it was years, maybe it was his entire life thus far. But like all of God's plans, a divine synchronization was about to take place. Verse 27, and he, Simeon, came in the spirit into the temple, and the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law. So what are Mary, Joseph, and the child doing in Jerusalem, in the Jerusalem temple? As we know from Luke and other gospel writers, that the birth of our Lord takes place in Bethlehem, a small town about 6 miles south of Jerusalem, a further 80 miles south from their Nazarene home in the north country. Well, as Jewish law states, every newborn male shall be circumcised on the eighth day of their life. Luke tells us this in verse 21. And at the end of the 8 days, when he was circumcised, he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. Now, we may assume that this circumcision took place in Bethlehem, not Jerusalem. It's doubtful that Mary would be up to such a journey. Now, there was another Jewish obligation that was to take place 40 days after a woman gave birth, and this would be the purification rite, where the new mother would be made ceremonially clean. And this is what brings them to Jerusalem. Also, the law of Moses required that the firstborn son of a family be consecrated to the Lord. In other words, the firstborn son should be put into priestly service. As you might imagine, this would make for an awful lot of priests. So what would normally happen was the family, if wealthy, they'd make a payment to get their son out of the priesthood. Or in the case of Mary and Joseph, who we know are not wealthy, the payment would be the purchase and the sacrifice of two young pigeons, two turtle doves. This highlights the fact that even in ancient times, parents would do anything to ensure that their kids wouldn't enter the ministry. Well, did these events necessarily have to take place in the Jerusalem temple? No, the local synagogue would have been just as appropriate. But as Mary and Joseph knew, that this child was unique, to say the least. And so the child Jesus was dedicated in the Jerusalem temple. So that's what the Holy Family were doing in Jerusalem. And again, verse 27, Simeon came in the spirit into the temple. The Holy Spirit directed the old man's path. And then here comes the action. Here comes the drama. Verse 28, and Simeon took the infant Jesus. Simeon took the baby in his arms. Now, most of us like holding babies. It's a joyous and wonderful feeling indeed. But it wasn't like Simeon was this child's uncle or anything. He didn't know the family. The family had never seen Simeon before in their lives. But of course, he doesn't pick up the baby Jesus because of any sort of natural instinct. No, Simeon holds the child up as an act of recognition. After all this time waiting for Israel's consolation, the promise that never seemed to develop after all these years where Simeon himself may have harbored doubts about the Messiah. Here at last, we have this heavenly picture of the aged Simeon holding the infant Savior. And what comes next is one of the most powerful and beautiful prayers ever spoken. It's called the Song of Simeon. He took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for the revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. This is the song of Simeon. O God, now I could die in peace because I have seen the Messiah. I have witnessed the consolation of Israel. The Song of Simeon, it's called the Nunc Dimittis in Latin, and it's been sung by the Christian church at least since the 4th century and right up to the present. Great composers have all set the Song of Simeon to music, from Jacquin des Prez to Palestrina, Thomas Tallis, to Mozart and Tchaikovsky and Ray Vaughan Williams. My personal favorite is Charles Villiers Stanford's setting. His Nunc Dimittis was sung as the recessional for Baroness Thatcher's funeral in St. Paul's in London. Margaret Thatcher, you may know, was the daughter of Alfred Roberts, a greengrocer and local Methodist preacher. And so I expect big things from my daughter as well. Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for the revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. It seems to me that Simeon, that this elderly Jew, was definitely not prepared to die in his sleep. He didn't want to go gentle in that good night. Simeon waited and waited so that he would see what the Holy Spirit had promised. His body was achy and tired, his stamina drawn. His steps were taken closer and closer together at this point. But his soul was strong. His eyes were still searching. His faith was impenetrable. No, all of that fear of missing out had now vanished. The fear of death was destroyed. Simeon had experienced the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and now was ready to die. Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. Marvelous words, aren't they? Now, have you ever experienced the fear of missing out when it comes to Christmas? Do you ever feel like there's more to life than what's currently out there? Do you sense that Christmas is much more than good cheer, a few days off work, gifts and music, mistletoe and wine? And we could easily miss Jesus and Christmas with all the externals, all the merriment and holiday making, the parties and get-togethers. But are we missing Jesus Christ in general? Not just during Christmas, but a life without God the Father, without the help of the Holy Spirit. Do we live without the light of revelation, the person and the Savior of Jesus Christ? Can we say with assurance and conviction that, oh Lord, now you are letting me depart in peace, that I don't need to fight anymore. I do not fear missing out. I know my future. I know my eternal rest. Those are words of devotion, words of love, words of faith. And joyfully surrendering to the Lord our God is only made possible because God sent his son, a helpless, wriggling baby. God sent his son so that we could experience forgiveness, acceptance, rebirth, and regeneration. It's only possible because of the infant Jesus. Loved ones, God is kind and benevolent. He's full of grace and mercy. And he gives us his prized creation. God gives to each of us a sense, an understanding that we are incomplete without him. He gives us a hunger and a thirst where we ultimately realize that there is one more place to visit, one more item on our bucket list, 1,001 things to see before we die. In fact, God gives us a fear of missing out. We have this longing, this desire. We know that we're built for more. We're often restless and discontent by nature. We have this nagging suspicion that for all of the pleasure and the places, the trips and the experience, for all the memories and the photographs, that there's still something more. But what could fill that void? More places to see? More food to taste? Another shot of adrenaline? And we may do a myriad of things to produce a sense of contentment or fulfillment. Shopping, sex, pills, careers, jobs. We may terminally educate ourselves through higher and higher degrees. We may master the piano, dominate a sport. We might even think that our family or our children will produce lasting fulfillment. But I tell you, without God, any and all attempts to satisfy spiritual urges will always and inevitably fail. The philosopher knows this. The pleasure seeker understands this. The lost man or woman senses that this is their predicament. But God, through Jesus Christ, is that satisfaction. Through faith in Jesus Christ, even the rawest, newest, even the simplest of faith begin to prepare us for the glories that we were promised in death. For the Christian, there is no FOMO. There is no fear of missing out. For through the infant Jesus, we were once lost, but God has now found us. And now we can say, Lord, you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. But this doesn't mean that when we come to faith that our earthly lives are trouble-free. Verse 33, and his father and his mother marveled at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, behold, this child is appointed for the fall and the rise of many in Israel, and for a sign that is opposed, a sword will pierce through your own soul also, so that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed. Simeon is saying to Mary, by the way, your child, he will also bring opposition. A sword will pierce through your own soul also. Simeon, a prophet, is speaking to Mary, a sword will pierce through your own soul also. 3 decades later, Mary will experience the agony of a mother losing her son, but she will ultimately share in the glory of resurrection. This opposition that Simeon speaks of, it's still with us today. It has never abated. There will be some who will know him as Lord and Savior, but there will be many more who hate him because he is Lord and Savior. There will be people who, like Simeon, recognize Jesus as Lord, and there will be people who refuse to acknowledge his authority. Some will follow Jesus, others will despise Jesus. The only thing we can't be is indifferent towards him. And so I ask you this Christmas Eve, what is your decision? Is Jesus Christ the Son of God? Is he the Savior of the world? Or is Jesus just a sweet baby that gives humanity a bit of hope in troubled times? Will Christ come again, where he says that all nations will gather before him, where every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord? Or is the nativity story too fantastical for our enlightened and sensible minds? I urge you tonight, brothers and sisters, accept Jesus Christ. Accept life. Accept freedom and forgiveness. For you may know him as Lord now, or you may know him as Judge later. If you are experiencing the spiritual fear of missing out this Christmas, then I ask you to take the next step in faith. Come to God in prayer. Ask him to forgive you. Ask him to recreate you. At the end of our service tonight, you'll find information on how to get in touch with our ministries. The community of faith in Lake Como, Shahawkin, and in Hancock are waiting to share the story of redemption with any and all. We want to guide you in your understanding of the Bible, what it means to be a Christian. We want to tell you what God's plan for humanity is. We want to deliver the most precious gift you could ever receive. The men and women of our churches want to make sure that all who are struggling, all who are confused and anxious, all who seek to live a life of peace, we want to make sure that there is no longer any fear of missing out in your life. The only thing that we are missing out on is you being part of our church family. It is my prayer this Christmas Eve that all who accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, for those who are strong in their faith, for those who are new to faith, those struggling with faith, it is my hope that as we settle into this holy night, that in our hearts and minds we come to God with the words of Simeon. Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and for glory to your people Israel. And now let us depart in joy and peace. God sent his angels from glory to bring us the good news of Jesus' birth. You have heard his story, the story of God's own Son. May he fill you with joy to bring this good news to others tonight and forever. Glory to God. Amen.